This is me, Manon, and my partner, Christian. The summer of 2020 has led us to Arctic Lapland, where we have set ourselves a mission to complete a trip we attempted 3 years ago, to reach the highest point in Finland. It's a 100-kilometre round trip, self-supported but with access to cabins for sleeping in along the way. Last time we were on skis in the depths of winter, and conditions made it impossible to get far. This time, we're trying again, by bike. As with every trip, it starts with the packing. Knowing what food, clothing, and spares to take for 3 nights is one thing, but fitting everything in is another, especially when one of your bags turns out to be the size of a GoPro.
And then we also got top tube bags, but I've just unpacked mine. I think 6 bananas will optimistic too. We have super porridge. But this is my sleeping bag and dry clothes for the evening. It's quite full.
2 baby bell cheeses from a month ago. And a sachet of hot chocolate, which might be wanted. Not baby bell cheeses.
Day one started early with a journey further north to the trailhead. Driving through the rolling landscape, we began to see hills and mountains in the distance. Last time we were here, everything was a blanket of snow, so we have no idea what the trail will be like. There's no crazy elevation change, but there's also no guarantee the trail will be rideable. Our first day will take us 30 kilometres up and over 1,000 metre high paths before descending down to a valley floor for the night. A smooth gravel path leads out from the car park, but it does not last long.
So, first bit of natural trail. We did a little climb on this stuff, and then this is what we assume the rest of it is going to be like. Oh my gosh, got hooked up on that. Oh my gosh. And yeah, this might be what we're in for the next 30k to tonight's cabin. So it's gonna be interesting.
The trail wound through the rocky terrain with sections littered with babyhead boulders, some blissfully smooth flow sections, wooden boardwalks, and pure out and out boulder fields.
First bit of flow!
Definitely feels like putting a hole in your tire type rocks and mashing mechs and discs. But we did have a smooth section, so maybe there'll be one.
Hey!
Oh. No pressure.
I remember this bit.
Sorry?
I think I remember this bit.
We could recognise different features in the landscape from our winter visit, so we had an idea at least of the distance we had to cover, at the start anyway.
We are going to Saarijärvi, along the Skullcap route.
Skullcap route? Sounds a bit gnarly.
We set off not knowing if the route was going to be doable with bikes, and the hikers we met early on definitely also had their doubts.
Terve! Joo.
Mikä on päämäärä?
Niin, pitkällä kun pystytään.
No niin, eihän siinä mitään.
Katsotaan mitä voi pyöräillä ja muuten vaan työnnetään. Tai kannetaan.
Kuuluu tunkkaaminen tohon lajiin.
Kyllä.
Olennainen osa. Ei joo. Mitään, hyvää matkaa.
Päivän jatkoi.
Pitäkää itsenä terveen.
Juu, kiitos.
We really didn't know what we were getting ourselves into, for just being outside, in the open landscape, carrying everything that we needed on us or on our bikes was just so refreshing.
Oh, a rock slab!
Maybe straight up to the grass bank there, straight in front of us. No! I guess I have to try though.
We had somewhere to be, but with plenty of daylight, there was no need to rush. We just plugged on, gradually making ground. The trail is dotted with huts every 10 kilometers or so, providing warmth and dry shelter when needed. Much better than sleeping outside.
There's ice on the side of the tent.
We had visited the first two huts 3 years previously in sub-20 temperatures, and revisiting brought back memories.
We just got to the first hut for lunch. Supposedly third of the way there now.
Got a little way to go.
Up a hill to the second hut and then all the way down to the third hut for sleep, hopefully.
10 km down.
After a quick stop, the trail continued upwards. We had 7 km of climbing to do before a long 12 km descent past the second hut and down to the third for the night. Straight after the hut was hard going, with more boulder fields to pass through. But after a while, the trail opened up into a surprisingly smooth, grassy trail, and our pace picked up.
You know what? We just rode into Norway!
Eventually, we made it to the highest point for the day, on top of a moonscape of grey rock and emptiness. Time was getting on, but we were greeted with flowy single track on the descent, and we were at the next hut before we knew it. Cracked on, revelling in the smoothness of the trails, until we came across something completely new to me on trail. Reindeer.
What do we do? Oh, there's one right by the trail.
Oh, yeah.
And they're running down. What do we do? What do we do?
We can just go.
Yeah. Make sure you look at them. Watch them walk.
The views were lovely on the way down into the valley, and the trail snaked down the boulder-free slopes. Progress was good, and our hut for the night was in sight, leaving us free to just enjoy the ride down. When we arrived, the huts were deserted. Overlooked by a large crag and surrounded by quiet lakes, we were completely, peacefully alone.
That is not bad.
Not bad at all.
This is home for the night. So yeah, end of an 8-hour day.
On day two, we woke up to blue skies and sun, looking like a great day to head for the top. We knew the peak was rocky from images we'd seen, and we wondered how far we would get with the bikes. We had a way to go before worrying about that though, with 25 kilometers of rocky approach still to go. Setting off from the hut, the trail was slow going. Boulder fields dominated along the lakeshore, with occasional respite thanks to wooden bridges.
Slightly sketchy bit of wood through the boulder field. And it's windy.
After the lake, the trail opened up into more rideable sections, followed by rockier walking sections, and the morning continued mostly like that.
Will we be able to bike a bit?
A mix of bike riding and bike pushing so far, between the boulder fields and wooden bridges.
Our first aim was a waterfall stop for lunch.
Oh, nice. Should we go swim?
So we still have quite a long way to go, but we've seen this waterfall. We already missed out on one, and it's going to be raining apparently tomorrow, so it's swimming time. It's going to be cold.
Continuing up the gradual climb, things started to get rockier again.
Now on Halti for tonight, and then we got three more K to the summit that we think we're gonna have to do on foot. I'm guessing that's the top.
Halti!
One and a half kilometers that way, but 4.5k to the top.
I don't believe it. All of these things have been
too
much.
So we're ditching the bikes. For the last bit, and then we'll blast down to the summit.
We're heading for the highest point in Finland, 50 metres from the actual peak of Halti, which is found across the border in Norway.
Highest point in Finland. So that is actually the highest point of this mountain, but it's in Norway.
Halti is a Caledonian igneous complex, which is basically a bunch of rocks that got melted when what is now Greenland crashed into North Central Europe 400 million years ago and has since been worn away by glaciers. It wasn't exactly tropical conditions at the top, so we signed the guestbook. Yep, there is a guestbook up there. Took in the views and headed back down to our hut for the night. Pretty sharpish.
It's snowing!
But it's snowing.
A dusting of snow and a savage headwind reminds us what latitude we were spending the summer at.
Done for the day.
The next morning wasn't quite the blue skies we'd had the day before. Morning coffee and spooning in the basic porridge took a little longer that morning, building up the courage to leave the warmth of the hut. At this point we were getting tired, but we knew there was more descent than uphill on the journey back.
Pretty windy. Fully wrapped up today, got a puffer on. Ready to go?
Yeah, good to go.
We would ride back down, all the way to the valley floor we had set off from on day two, before taking a little detour over a pass to avoid some of the bold fields, and heading up to our hut for the night. Almost everywhere we had some gradient, the trail rode surprisingly well, eating up the kilometres in between the flat, janky bald fields. The ride from the waterfall to the valley floor was awesome. Smooth sections in between the rocks felt like a dream, and we kept being surprised by how much you could actually ride through the rough stuff. At the valley floor we made a detour, following advice from the bikepacker who'd passed us the day before. We knew we'd have to cross some rivers, but didn't realise quite how wide or deep they'd be.
So, the trail has just run out here. We want to get to those huts there, but there's a bit of a stream river in between. Maybe it might be a shoes off. I don't want to get my socks wet. Oh, here goes, wet feet.
Our detour gave us a nice descent and dropped us into a valley with the smoothest trails of the trip. No more boulder fields for us today! Eventually we joined back up with the trail from the first day and slowly limped our way back up the 10km climb to our overnight hut. Low on food and energy, it was time to head back to Kilpisjärvi.
Morning, last day. Just getting ready to go. We're going up here. It's pretty windy down here, so we think it's going to be even windier up there.
Day four was a tough one. We had a nice climb and descent ahead of us, but then a long, flat, rocky drag to get back to civilization. Our bikes and packs were lighter now, but arms were definitely tired from battling against the rocks. Climbing up through the chossy rocks, the top of the pass came into view.
We're just pushing up the last bit from the hut to the top. Pretty rocky. We're a little bit worried about what the wind is going to be like when we get to the top. There's a headwind at the moment.
Our finish point was in sight, and we blasted down the trail that we had ridden up 3 days before, weary but satisfied. It wasn't over yet though. At midday we reached the very first hut that we'd come across, 12 kilometres out from Kilpisjärvi. Now, between us and the finish point was a pretty flat traverse across rocky terrain and boulder fields, with what had become a relentless headwind that made riding, or even just pushing in a straight line, a battle.
My arms are goose.
Tired and running out of enthusiasm, the end was getting closer and closer.
Not a bad view.
Yeah. Soon we were out of the worst and had a final descent to enjoy before passing the last lake to get back to the comfort of the gravel road that we left on the first day. 100 kilometers over 4 days, with maybe around 70 kilometers riding, 25 kilometers pushing, and 5 kilometers carrying, we'd gotten twice as far as we had on skis and completed the mission of Halti. But the best part was just getting out into the simplicity of nature. You have a destination, but your focus is always the journey, what you are doing at each moment along the way. No to-do list other than to put one foot or one paddle stroke in front of the other and embrace the elements. When you feel like you're the only people around.
Last paddle stroke then. Roll down to the car.
The final stretch brought back feelings from the trip 3 years earlier, when our starting point finally came back into view and we knew we'd made it back safely. With nothing left for me to do but pizza down the snowy road to my heart's content.